future should awaken in us a sense of mission more than a sense of guilt. And that's what I hope to do this morning. Amen. Instead of saying, oh, you did all this stuff bad, because we all already know that kind of stuff, right? I can hand out paper and y'all can list all the stuff that you need to improve on in your life. And that's a good thing. We should understand that, and we should recognize that. We should all repent of that, right? I mean, you don't need me to tell you that. I believe that's the Holy Spirit's responsibility this morning, right? It's also the Holy Spirit's responsibility to help teach us and help encourage us and strengthen us for the mission that we're about to do. And I believe that I'm trying to, with all my heart, to change the mission of what the church is about. Amen? And part of that is recognizing that this building is not the church. Can I hear amen? I'm from the South. I grew up in the South as a Christian, so I want to hear like some amen. I want to respond so I know you're actually awake for the next 30 minutes, all right? So we believe that this church building is kind of nice. We have a big cross that used to be part of the pews that were in this church years ago. So we have a little history here. This building's been a church for early 70s, so it's great. It's a building that we come and worship, but this is not the church. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Let me say it again. This is not the church. Amen. This building is not the church. We're not going to church. We are the church, going to a place to gather together with God's people.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on. This is the difference between Christianity and kind of institutionalized Christianity. We have to come to a place where we can worship God, or do we worship God every day in our homes, in our workplace, as we're driving down the road? That's the difference that I want to create in us. Hopefully in the next, sooner than later, because I believe there's time for us to do what God's called us to do. So Angela's going to come, and she's going to be a testimony about the Power and Love Conference. I asked her to share, because she was struggling a little bit about that, and I think we're all struggling with this. So, can I give you this?
Yeah, you did.
Well, it's because we're recording.
Oh,
so.
Okay.
So, here
you go.
Just set that there.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you.
Yeah, that's good.
Good morning, everybody. During the meet and greet, Pastor Bob asked if I mind sharing about my experience going to the School of Power and Love, which is about 2 weeks ago now. Todd White, which I had not heard of him before I attended, but now I'm glad that I know who he is. He is a phenomenal speaker, but went out to the conference, and I was only able to go on one night. They had it all, I think it was like a week long, and it was Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and there were daytime sessions and evening sessions. So I went to the evening session, and there were people sharing about how the daytime session had impacted them, where they had been built up in a way where they were dispatched out into the community to go pray for people. And so they were reporting back about how they'd gone to the mall and were listening in tune with the Holy Spirit about who to pray for. So they would walk up to random people in the mall and ask them if they needed healing in any part of their bodies, or if they prayer for, and how people were receiving healing from just random conversations in the mall. So it was such an exciting, it's an exciting time. You're just really, really built up in belief in God, and yes, I can do this. I can just impact the world for Jesus Christ. It was just a really, really great time. The challenge comes after, though. You leave that type of setting. So for me, it was like, yeah, you know, you get all built up around these Christians, such a loving, encouraging environment. I'm like, all right, God, I'm going to walk in unconditional love and really just do awesome things for you. Left that setting, and I encountered a challenging person unlike any other person I've dealt with before up until this point in time. And so I was like, all right, God, you put on my heart to go to this conference. I feel like I'm supposed to really be consistent in my love walk. And it's easy to love people that are easy to love. In a church setting, it's easy for us to love one another. Yes, we're all believe the same things. We, you know, hopefully all loving people. But it's outside the four walls, it can be a bit more challenging. And so this particular person I interacted with is an organization I'm a part of. And I have a scripture in the tagline of my email that I've been using within this organization. So I'm like, all right, people kind of know I'm a Christian if they read my email, so I can't step out of the box and not represent. If they know me for this platform without me necessarily saying it, let me be a full representation of who God is. So I was sharing with Dion and Jane on Wednesday about this one lady who's just, for no reason whatsoever, just been very, very combative about everything. You just want to say some things to her just to shut her down, just let her know, no, you can't approach me that way. Like, that is one good time is all it would take. But that would take away from representing the love of God. So that is, I guess, the gist of my testimony is I've been very I've been using that opportunity to sharpen my love walk. It's like, all right, God, when I see her, I'm going to pray for her. I'm not going to respond to her in the way that she is trying to force me to naturally, because I could say some things. But instead, I'm going to be like, no, you don't realize what you're doing. So let me represent a different way to hopefully change who you are. You'll come to know Christ in a new way through what you see through me. So that's my testimony for School of Power and Love. It's forcing me to step my game up, and it was a good time considering when I'm at the same weight. So,
amen. So I, with the same atmosphere, when I prayed for my family members, I tried to represent the love of God also. When the enemy came in like a flood to discount what I was doing, then this self-righteous indignation, whatever, came up in me, and I had to stand up for Jesus. But then at that moment, I thought, I don't have to stand up for Jesus. I just need to be silent. And so when I said to her, and I said in a loud voice that only those that believe in the Son of God is when we pray for my sister, and the presence of God filled the room. It was, I'm telling you, it's never anything like I've ever felt before in my whole life. I stood up immediately because I was going to say something, like correct the whole situation. But I stood up, and we were tired because it was a long couple days, but it was as I stood up, and immediately I just sat right back down because there was nothing I needed to say. Because everybody in the room felt the presence of God, amen? So I didn't need to say, you're all wrong, and you're messed up in your theology, and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I believe that God wants to use us in His love, and then His power. His love first, because that's what He commanded us, to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, body, and strength, and to love our neighbor. Now, how many know how hard that can be? Come on, it's hard. If you see somebody, you know, that's not acting right or treating their children wrong or their wife wrong or their husband wrong, or you see that stuff and you go, God, how can you love those people? What He does. And I can't explain it. I don't know what happens in me. And I'm praying that God changes my love for people in a way that is like Him instead of like me. You know, how many of us know that we just judge really easily when we see something not right? It's automatic. We do it. Don't. One person was honest. Thank you, actually. Because we judge immediately people. And if we can try to change our love language and saying, hey, I want to love that person no matter how they look or how they act, or even if they're rude, because we don't know what they're going through. Father God does. And we need to reach out and love them, because we're the only extension of God's love, the tangible that is in the world. And if we as Christians want to argue and fight about theology and about this or that, then the world's going to say, well, I don't even need that. And we have it easy in America. I'm thinking about those Christians right now in Mosul that are being kicked out of their homes, and either you denounce Christ or die by the sword is what they said, or leave. I mean, they tell them to leave, and then they rob them on the way, so they're leaving with nothing, heading up north in Iraq. I mean, what about those Christians? I mean, we don't have anybody coming to our houses right now and kicking us out, or putting a sword to our throat and saying, deny Christ. I mean, those are the Christians. I mean, they're demonstrating. I don't know. I told Tina this morning, I don't know. I think I would die. I don't think I would denounce Christ. There's just no way. I don't think I could ever say that Jesus, I would say Allah or whatever instead of Jesus Christ. There's just no way. So I would die. I mean, I don't know where you're at today, but I'm just thinking, I would not. We just talked about this morning, you know. What if we were in that situation? I would have to get Christ first, and everything else is not important. And put things in perspective, doesn't it? Hallelujah. So, anyway, we'll pray for that at the end of the service. I'm not even going to preach on that today or teach on that today. But anyway, it's just something that's happening in the world. Look at the TV set. Look at the news. Look at all the news. I mean, there's stuff not all over the world. Bad things are happening. Well, the bad thing has been happening since the beginning of time. Cain and Abel killed, you know, I mean, come on, murder in Genesis 1, chapter 1 and 2. So, you know, there's bad things happening all over the world. We have to demonstrate the love of Christ when we see that. and give people hope. The only hope that's real is through Jesus Christ. Amen. So we have to be that person. So anyway, today I want to talk about, let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to talk about the will of God. And I'm going to start with the Lord's Prayer. I was sharing with my family, kind of inspired this. I wanted to connect with some of their religious background a little bit so they could connect with me when we pray for my sister. And so what I thought, I was praying and I asked the Holy Spirit, what should I do? And you know, most people, if they have a little bit of religious background, especially mainline denominational, they'll know the Our Father. So I thought, well, I'll start there. And then I shared with them what Bob Sorge shared, that we have authority over our enemies. And so I said, I taught them about the prayer that Bob Sorge taught, that we have justice from our enemies in Mark chapter 18. And so I shared both of these with them, and we prayed. And then they learned, my sister learned, that you could actually pray aloud, which is kind of cool, you know, because if you have, you know, I grew up as a Catholic, she did too, so, you know, so everybody silent prayer, bow your heads. Okay, take a minute. Are you all praying? Praying, okay, and then the priest would say amen, and that would be in the prayer. That was prayer time. And so when you grow up in that, that's all you know. But when I shared with them that you could actually pray out loud, that was really cool. That was a revolution to them. So that was good. Anyway, so let's look at this. This is the Lord's Prayer. Jesus taught the disciples how to pray. Most of us know this. And he said, pray this way, or pray this type of prayer, how you should pray. It says, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. We're going to stop right there. Okay, so it says, Our Father in heaven. I don't know about some of you, but we taught that. You know, we praise God. When you go to God, if you want something from your daddy, I don't know, it's always good to butter up a little bit. Hey, how you doing, Dad? You looking good today? You lost some weight, didn't you? You know, you want to praise him and thank him and thank God for all he's done. It's like, you know, and then you tell God this, and it'd be great if my kids would do this to me. Dad, whatever you want, I'll do. Wouldn't that be cool? Man, parents, come on. Wouldn't it be great? Your kids, when Gracie grows up and she says, Daddy, you know, whatever you want, I'm going to do, that'd be amazing. It'd be great. But it's not the way it works sometimes, and that's okay because we all have a will. But here we go. It says, God, Jesus said the next thing he said after you praise him and thank him for what he's done, for all creation. I mean, whatever you have, I think everything I have, my car, my wife, my kids, my fifth grandchild being born, all of them are God's. Amen. God gave them to me, and I thank him for it. And then I have trouble praying this part, though. Your kingdom come, and your will be done. I think this is where we all kind of struggle with it. That's why I wanted to explore this a little bit. So we look at the will. What is God? What is will? Will is the wishes or determinations of what God wants us to do or to be done. Or for his purpose, God's will is to bless you and me. What his purpose is, we want to do what he wishes, what he commands, right? I mean, we have the law. I mean, could you imagine trying to figure that all out and what to do or not to do? And Jesus said, I know you have struggled with that, so I'm going to make it real simple for you. All you religious people, let me just break it down so you can understand. I want you to love Father God, and I want you to love other people. And we've been struggling with that ever since, amen? So I pray, God, help my unbelief so I may believe. Help me to love you, Father. Let me understand your love for me. I don't even get it. And I've been doing this for a long time. I don't understand the fullness of his love and his grace and his forgiveness for me. Even when I have a bad attitude, I think he's just like, hey, he's kind of like, come on, son. It's okay. You know? Or when I get that judging moment in my mind when I look at people, does it, you ever get that where you kind of look at something and go, man, they're all messed up. And then you start comparing yourself to them, like you're better than them because you have this or that, or you have this far in your career, or you're that far in your career, or whatever, and you kind of just, you know, hey, I'm better than you, because that's what society does. That's why I don't want to call the building the church, because this church model is built on a business model that we have to be success by numbers, by these, you know, count everything. We have 208 chairs in here, so, you know, we're not, you know, we're at 10 or 12% here, that's it today. You know, so we must have had a bad Sunday. You know, so we're looking at that, but I don't look at that. I'm thanking God that each of you came today. And it's taken me a long time to get there. So I can say, hey, you showed up today. I'm grateful that you're here. And I'm hopefully that whatever the Lord gave me, I can pass on to you. And I'm not going to judge you from this position. I want to encourage you to be the light And going to that conference was really a revelation for me, because I was like, I need that. I need to, when I see a person in the mall or in a store or I'm driving on the road, and the Holy Spirit, like me and my son after the conference, I'll tell on ourselves, right? So after the conference, we went home and we had some tables from the birthday party, so we're bringing them back to church. But on the way here, there was a young man walking with a cane down the road, down on by Sheboygan Avenue, right? And so we drove right by him, you know, because we had a task to do. And then we were getting back to the house, and we drove right by him a second time, right? So I we got to the house, I told my son, I said, son, what did you think about that young man that was with the cane? He goes, well, we should have stopped and talked to him. I said, why didn't you? Because now I was a dad, and he was my son, so he was like respecting me. But we all both had the same idea, but we didn't stop. So we had to say, wow, Lord, let us not do that again. Right? Because the Holy Spirit is always drawing people to Christ, and He's always wanting to use us. God's will is that none shall perish. The will of God that is none shall perish. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and come to the full knowledge of truth. So God wants people to be saved, right? I accepted Jesus. What's being saved mean? Go to John 3:16. Go to all those verses we're talking about saying. It means that they acknowledge Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Right? They believe in their hearts. They confess with their mouth, in Romans 10:9-10, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. How can you be saved? Because you finally realize that you needed a Savior. You were sinful, and you needed somebody to help you. And that day, I remember that day, January 20th, 1980, I gave my life to Jesus. What did that mean? I grew up as a Catholic. I was an altar boy, so I was in a religious setting. I knew all that. I knew what to do and not to do. I knew where the priest kept the wine in the back. Okay, I knew all that stuff. But what I didn't know is I needed a Savior. And that moment when I realized that I was a sinner, I accepted Jesus, my life was saved. That is the will of God. Now, it doesn't end there, which is interesting in the verse when Paul wrote in 1 Timothy. It says that you come to save, but also that you come to the knowledge of truth. Will you turn your Bibles there to 2 Timothy? Just look at it. 1 Timothy 2:4. Just look through it in your Bible. Grab your pen and underline this, if you will. I write in my Bible all the time, so you can write in yours. I give you permission. Who wants all men, this God our Savior, verse 3, who wants all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of truth? So in that moment, in that hospital room, in that waiting room, when my sister-in-law was saying, oh, you can, I hope she doesn't listen to this tape, but anyway, the truth is the truth. She was saying that, oh, I have friends that are Jehovah's Witnesses, I got Buddhist friends, I got Hindu friends, they're all praying for Paula. At that moment, I could have just been silent. You know, I love my sister-in-law. I want her to come to the full knowledge of Christ. I could love her, or I could share the truth with her. Sometimes that's where the conflicts come in, because now you're sharing truth. You're not saying it's you. I'm saying it's not me that says you have to be saved and feel. It's God that said it through His Word that you have to be saved. And what does that mean? We can teach that on that. Most of you know that. And then you have to come to the truth. So what is truth? They, in my family, because they're not really strong Christians, they'll say, well, what makes you think, I mean, you know everything. I said, I don't know everything. All I know is God is truth. And some basic truth is that Jesus Christ is the Son of every religion that doesn't confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Oh, He's a good prophet. Well, He was a prophet and a king and a priest, but not just a prophet. He was the Son of God. They won't confess that. Then you know that's a false teaching, right? Love them, try to share the truth with them, but don't waste your time, just go on. Amen? There's so many people that don't know that simple truth. When Jesus confronted Peter, and Peter said, you are the Christ, you're the Son of God, and Christ said, upon that truth I will build my church. So what is the truth that He was going to build on? He was the Son of God. Amen. That's how you know you're going to a church that's teaching truth, to teach that part right there. Now there's some, that's why I told, in previous to the conversation right before that, I told my brothers and sisters I wasn't going to get into a theological discussion today because we're here about my sister. But we're going to talk about that. That's not important. The important part is that God can heal. And you speak into a person that's on their deathbed and you speak life into them. I believe God can do that. There's no doubt in my mind. When I watched the monitor and her blood pressure started going up to normal and her respiratory, she started breathing more beats per or times per minute, I knew that she was going to overbreathe that machine eventually. I didn't know when, but I could see just in that moment as we prayed, I prayed for her. And in the room was my brother and his son. And before we left, I said, can we pray? They don't, you know, their prayer is this. Can God answer silent prayer? Yes. God can answer any prayer. But I'm just saying, I speak. When you speak, something, faith comes out. So I have to speak for myself. I have to speak for myself. I believe that you are whole because of Jesus. And see, I have to go back there again to finish praying for her so God will finish healing her body. I believe he's already started in the Word. So I want to give God, glory to God for what happens. And this is what they say. Oh, Paul's a strong fighter. That's what they say, right? No, she's not a strong fighter. She needs Jesus at this time. That's the truth. The truth sometimes, does he ever hear that the truth hurts? The only reason it hurts is because it offends our thinking and our theology and our belief system. When truth is confronted, it's like, well, that's not right. Man, I don't know about that. Because you haven't studied the Word of God. That's why you don't know. What is the will of God? That everyone is saved and that everybody comes to truth. Amen? Now that's... Let's look at John 6:38 says this, I am he that does the will of the Father. What did Jesus come for? He came to do the will of the Father. John is 6:38. I came to do the will of the Father. What was the will of the Father? That everybody become saved, right? So the will of the Father for Jesus was what? To be the perfect sacrifice. From the beginning, he knew that. He was going to die, and he had to teach his disciples that it was going to happen. So John 5:30 says this, seek not my own, I came to seek not my own will, but the will of the Father. He says it over and over, Matthew 12:50. If you do not do the will of the Father, you are not my brothers or sisters or mother or father. Or those that do the will of the Father are my brother, sister, mother, father. What is he saying? What is the will that we do? Are we going to die for this gospel? Are we not in Romans 10, Romans 8 says that we're supposed to be living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto God? Come on, be encouraged, put a smile on your face. This is okay, this is good stuff. Right? Because God wants all of us. He wants all of us. He doesn't want part of us. So I tell people, what if I'm going to University of Madison and I'm getting my education? Get your education, get the best you can get, but don't forget God in the process. Amen? You can be a psychologist and still love Jesus. Amen? Holly, my family's, I come from the most dysfunctional family in America, or in the world, all right? They had a horrible, my heart is so broken for my family. I've been praying for them since I left on Wednesday. They're just, I see things that happened in their childhood that are still being acted out today. Now, I'm not a psychologist, I just know that generational curses come, and they affect you, even the way you think, the way you act, and everything, and those things need to be broken in the name of cholesterol. He has a physical problem. His liver produces cholesterol. He's had 2 quadruple bypass surgery. He was going to be here this morning, but they couldn't make it yet. He's a believer. He loves Jesus, and he does stuff to help keep cholesterol out of his body, and he's 76 years old. Now, his grandfather died when he was 30. His uncle, his brother died when he was 25, all of cholesterol. And so that means that our family is going to have high cholesterol, or my sister, 2 of her main arteries were clogged, right? So that means, I don't have to accept that. In the name of Jesus. When I became a believer in 1980, that's one of the things I prayed about after I learned about this. I don't have to accept that. I don't have to be that way because my family's that way. See, I can break that curse, so now my children and my children's children and my children's children's children will become believers of Jesus. Amen? So I believe there's a blessing in that. So we don't have to accept that. I know people that were abused when they were little, as a child, and they think that they have to carry that abuse with them all through adulthood. No, they don't. I believe God can heal that. I believe that God can make somebody that wasn't a virgin before they get married, because the love of God will heal all the hurts and all the pains. I believe my God can do that. If he can forgive anything, then he can forgive those things in our lives. Amen? And now he can forgive them if we did them wrong or they were done wrong to us, but he can bring healing to them. When his blood, when those stripes were bore on his back, that means every manner of sickness and disease. It didn't say, well, except for this or for that. It doesn't say that in the Word of God. It says everything. Read it for yourself. I believe God is still healing today. Amen? God is living. When you hear some of those testimonies from the Power and Love Conference, amazing things. A lady, one of the things that happened the last night of the service, there was a couple young people went out. They were at the mall. West Town Mall will never be the same. The presence of God. You walk into West Town Mall, the presence of God's there. There's so many people got healed and delivered in that place. It was just crazy. All the people that worked at the kiosks there, they all got prayed for many, many times, you know? What's going on here? A bunch of people got off the bus and started healing people. It's just amazing, right? The lady walking from the mall, going to her car, right? Little walker, right? Some young people prayed for her, right? God totally healed her, took her walker, threw in her trunk, right? And she came, of course, they testified about that, about what happened. But what was really cool about it, she came to the meeting that night. And she's up there, totally healed. And what's really cool about that, Pam Berkowitz, who's our campus pastor, one of our campus pastors here, she knows a lady. So she knows how much pain and she's been in. And so it's kind of just a testimony. God can do that. All you have to simply believe is, well, all you have to do is believe. And I think you have to do. Right? You have to believe it's the will of God that He wants to see us. It's, you know, it's really kind of, think about this, saints. It's really an easy target. You see somebody with a walker, you know they need healing. You don't have to go, you know what I'm saying? It's really interesting. All I have to do is ask them, hey, what happened to you? And they'll tell you their whole life story. Somebody said it's like they throw up on you. Just tell, you know, they're just waiting for somebody to just be compassionate. And all of a sudden, boom, their whole life. They tell you their whole story. It's, I love it. I just love sitting out there on a curb and they tell you the whole story. And then you listen to the Holy Spirit. As the Holy Spirit is talking, as they're talking to you, you're listening to the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God will say, see that? Pray for that. Pray for this. Pray for that. They'll reveal everything. And then all of a sudden you say, listen, I believe that God wants me to pray for this. You had this issue when you were a child, or you had this issue when you were growing up. And all of a sudden, how do you know that? Because I know the Creator, the God who loves you, and wants to use me. I want to show that love to you. He wants to show that love to you. And you just pray for them. It's fun, actually. I leave there skipping down the sidewalk because I'm so happy that God used me. I'm like a little kid in the candy store. Whoo, got $5 and got a bunch of candy. I remember Mom giving me 50 cents to get Tipsy Rolls at the store. I had a little bag of Tipsy Rolls. I was so happy to get that. I feel like that. I feel like a little kid. I'm just happy that God used me because I'm nobody. I just want to see, I want to be Jesus in my world. That's the will of God for you and me. Amen. 1 Thessalonians, turn to 1 Thessalonians in chapter 4. I'm going to end real soon with this. It'll be a short sermon today. You know that Nike commercial says, just do it, you know, the logo? That's like put on every one of your foreheads. Just do it, just do it. Just do it, do it, do it. I'm afraid. Yes, we're afraid because in our own spirit we can't do it. We can't. But with the power, now think about this, I think Tina said it a few weeks ago, she said, the Holy Spirit doesn't need to take an IQ test. He knows everything, right? He knows everything. And if God gave him all knowledge, and the Spirit is not going to say anything he doesn't hear from the Son, and the Son's not going to hear anything that he hears from the Father, is they're going to do the same thing, the same will, the same purpose, all three of them, and when we believe, come on, when we believe, the Spirit of God was deposited in us. So you want to say, I want to have more compassion. You can have more compassion because the Spirit of God is in you. And you just have to listen to the Spirit. And when you listen to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is not going to lead you to a wrong place. He knows everything. So when he puts in your heart like that young man we didn't stop and pray for, which we should have, and I had to repent from that. So if we would have went and stopped and prayed for him, what would have God done for that man? If anything, he would have been told that God cares about him, at the minimum. On the other hand, God could have healed him and he could have went skipping down the sidewalk himself, right? That's what God can do. Why not? How many is tired of coming to church on Sunday? Come on. I mean, just come to church. I mean, it's exciting to come. I love being together with God's people. Don't get me wrong. I love this time. I really do. I love to get to know all of you. But I know there's a difference when I'm acting out Christianity and the love of God outside these four walls. Something happens in my belief system that strengthened me to carry on. When God can just use me to touch a life. Amen? I'm excited about that. I believe God wants to. I think that's my only message that I preach. I've been preaching this message since I've been here 9 years. It's not about this building. It's about us being the church. Amen? It's about us being the church and being the church in our community and around us. 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 3 says, "It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality." Can everybody say amen to that?
Amen.
That's such a big thing. I mean, I'm watching TV, right? You could just count, just get a piece of paper one day while you're watching TV, just the commercials. I mean, you can watch a baseball game, whatever. Just watch whatever you watch for an hour. Just write down all the things that you see that you're just allowing to come into your eyes, into your spirit. It's crazy. You know, oh, it's just a little sex scene. They showed the butt of the guy. They didn't really show anything. Right? Or they show him in bed. I mean, come on. This doesn't leave much to imagination. It's just crazy. It's just, I mean, and it says, and here God's saying avoid that kind of stuff. But we let it happen. Or we'll go pay good money to go to a movie that's now maybe not rated R, but, you know, maybe, what is it, PG-13? Come on, I said there was no guilt. This is a happy time, right? Come on, don't look at me bad. I'm just telling you the truth here. Don't get upset, okay? Pastor Bob loves you. There's things that we allow as believers that don't. So we're ready to inundate ourselves with something on TV for 4 hours or 5 hours, but we can't go outside our door and ask our neighbor if we can pray for them. Or bring a box of cookies to our neighbor on our right side and maybe a pie to the neighbor on our left side so we just get to know them. Because our purpose, our real purpose in life is to share the love of Christ. And we can't do it when we're cooped up in our little houses, watching stuff that we're not supposed to look at. He says, just read the Bible anytime, read it anywhere. It talks about the same thing. From Genesis to Deuteronomy, it talks about this sexual sin. This is something that we have to deal with, right? Sex is not a bad thing, but used in the wrong context, it can lead to destruction. Hello? God loves you. Amen? I love you. All right? I wasn't going to go there today. It kind of spilled out on you, so there you go. You get it for free. That each of you should learn to control your own body, hello, in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the heathens who do not know God. We can't be like, there's some Christians say, we've got to be in the world, you know, so we can win them. You don't have to go drinking with them. You don't have to go do stuff with them that's going to cause you to sin or bring you down. You need to do things that will build you up in the faith. So go to the, I tell people, just go to the bar with them, but drink a Coke. You know, go to the fair or whatever. You should be light everywhere you go, but be light. Don't kind of be like a light that has a shade on it, you know? So you kind of, you know, be a Christian, but you're kind of like blending in a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Come on. You're just kind of, you're there, but no, be a light. Be a bright, shining light. But love them because you're not condemning them. That's what Jesus did. Remember Zacchaeus? I love Zacchaeus' story. Zacchaeus was a sinner. When Jesus came to his house for dinner, right? He gave back 4 times what he stole. I mean, who told him that? He was just in the presence of God. You know what happens when you're light in a situation like that? You go to a company picnic, you know, everybody's doing their thing, drinking their beer, whatever, and you're just there and you're having fun with them, and then all of a sudden there's a conversation strikes up. It never fails someone to ask about God. Because they know who you are. They know who you believe in. And then you don't have to, you can just share with them. It's great. It's just a conversation. What do you think about this? Or what do you think about that? Then you tell them truth. Then they have to deal with it. Because just, to me, it always leads to another question, right? Well, what about the babies dying in Africa? Or what about this? Or what about AIDS? And what about, you know, they always want to know about the other things. And the truth is they really want to know about themselves and their security in God. So because you love them and you answer your questions without condemning them, then they're open up to the other part. Well, how do you feel about God? Do you think he loves you? Man, wait till you that answer. That's kind of really cool. No, most people say no, because they feel like all the guilt and all the shame. And you know, God can take all that away, and it just opens up the door. So you don't have to be separate from the world, but don't be like them. I mean, see how many shots you can do and, you know, drink each other under the table. Oh, Jesus is winner, you know? I don't think that one works, but you know what I'm saying? So anyway, you can go on, read it for yourself. This is, you know, how many, don't raise your hand. You know, you have to, if you want to change your thinking about how you should be as a Christian, then you need to be in the Word of God, because the Word of God washes your mind and makes you think the way He wants you to think. Amen? Go over to 5:18. Here's what God's will is for you and me. 5:18. Verse 16. Be joyful always. Pray continuously. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. That's good, right? Pastor Bob ended on a good note. Be joyful always. Pray continuously. Give thanks in all circumstances. How many have trouble giving thanks in all circumstances? I get to the end of the payday, end of the month, there's not enough money, and we start complaining just like everybody else does. Or do we go, thank you, Jesus, and help me through the situation, because I know you're the resource of everything I need. Faith, truth, amen? And God will help you through that every time. I mean, He's proven Himself to this place so many times, it's almost crazy. We could write a book on how to believe, right, Dion? How do we believe? Man, I don't know how it works out sometimes, but you know, we've been here 9 years, and every month, all our bills have been paid in this little church building. Amen? Why? Because we just simply believe. Sometimes we can't do stuff, it's fine. I mean, I got into the grumbling mode for a while, so don't get me wrong. I'm just as worldly, as fleshly as everybody else. I have to struggle with myself, too. But then sometimes I get the guys together, and you know what we do? We just pray, because we don't have an answer. We pray and believe, and God shows up always. I want to close with one more verse, if you don't mind. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation 2:26-28 says, to the one who is victorious and does my will to the end, I will give authority over all the nations. I just think that God gives us, He wants us to go to the end, and we will never know the power that we have in Him if we just endure to the end. He says He'll give us authorities over the nations. It says in the end times of Revelation, we will be kings and priests over people. We'll get into that today, but I'm just telling you, there's a reward if we'll just stay and do His will continuously. Amen? What is God's will? God's will is that every person will be saved and know the truth. We have to go to the end. A lot of us just want to end right there. You know, I grew up in another denomination, and it was always about this being saved, so we just have to talk about that. And it was okay, now they're saved, now what do we do with them, you know? Well, you have to lead them to truth. You have to teach them and learn. And there's things in our lives that we might not be doing the way God wants us to do. That's fine. Amen? I mean, you just ask God what you should do, and He will tell you. I don't have to tell you that. Matter of fact, I could give you a list. I told when I first came here, I said, I'm not going to make a list of all the do's and don'ts of what you should or shouldn't do as a believer. Because that's easy. But I can tell you this, why don't you just ask the Holy Spirit who's in you what you should or shouldn't do, and He will tell you. And what happens, and faith begins to grow up inside of you. Some of you probably know, some of you knew when I'll tell the story anyway, and I'll close with the story. Tony Mikichuk was a young Marine when I was in the Marine Corps. Tony Mikichuk was on phone watch during lunch in Okinawa, Japan, and I happened to go back to the shop where I was working a little bit early, and Tony Mikichuk had this little Bible. It was a Gideon Bible. He was reading it. And I said to him, I walked in and I said, hey, that's a good book you're reading. And he was a Norwegian guy with blonde hair, blue eyes, you know, and he just lit up like a, you know, wow, so there's another believer. You know, he was all excited. He lit up and we became really good friends. And as a new believer, and I don't know how he got saved, I just know he was a new believer. And at that time I was just working towards studying for my credentials, and I was going back to, we went to Naha Port, which is the capital of Okinawa, and we're just sightseeing, you know, going through the shops, just kind of interesting to see all the culture and the different things that they do and how they cook their food and just this craziness. But anyway, it was kind of fun viewing that. But on the way back from Nahapur, we're heading to go back. I was going to go back and study, and he wanted to go to a movie. And there's a movie playing at the theater. It was a rated R movie. I don't know what it was. Most movies are rated R, would have violence, all that kind of stuff anyway. But he wanted to go see this movie, and he asked me this question as we're walking. You know, we're talking about things of God, just casual. He said, "Do you think I should go to the movie?" And as somebody mentoring somebody, I could instantly say, "Don't go because this and this and this," and then he would have probably listened to me. But I knew enough to learn. I knew enough at that point, even on my young walk with the Lord, I knew that the Holy Spirit could give him a better answer than I could. So I told him this. I said, "Tony," I said, "go to the theater, pay your $2 to get in, and when you're in the theater, ask God if you should be there. If he says don't stay, then you must leave, you'll be obedient and listen. If he says stay and watch the movie, then enjoy the movie," you know? And I left it like that. I went to my barracks, and I was studying actually the book of John at the time, and I was doing my notes and stuff. And I'll say 10 minutes later, there was a knock on my door. And I opened the door, and this is the first words he said to me. I love this because I tell this story all the time. He says, "God spoke to me. God spoke to me, God spoke to me, God spoke to me." He's just all excited because he heard the voice of God. And I always thought to myself, if I told him not to go, then it would have been Bob told him. But now he knows that God can speak to him just like he can speak to anyone else, like he can speak to you. Because the same Holy Spirit that is in him is in you and me today. Amen? And he speaks to us daily. So what is the will of God for your life? Well, pray and ask him. Amen? Just pray and ask him, what should I do? And he will tell you. The God that knows everything in this universe will tell you exactly what you should do. Amen? First of all, he wants you to be a light for the world. Be saved yourself. Know him and know what truth is. So you have to study the Word of God because that's important. Amen? And then share what you learn with the world around you. Amen? If God healed you, you share that. If God blessed your finance, he shares that. If he helped you, you know, your faith increased by doing an action of kindness, then tell people that. And give God all the glory. Amen? And give God all the glory. When you lay hands on the sick and somebody heals them, don't go, "Look what I did." And that's what was really cool about the Love Conference, is that when those young people came up in groups, they went out by groups, they come and they gave Jesus all the glory. "God used me." Amen? And he healed that person, and he healed that person. And this person, I remember Walter standing up at the platform going, "Today," because a group after group prayed for him. Right? And then finally, there's some young men prayed with them. Walter was an African-American guy, big guy, and he was just at the mall and at the food court. And these guys actually, after praying for him, get prayed for a few times, and this one gentleman and his group actually shared Jesus with them. And he stood up there and said, he goes, "Today, I no longer serve Satan, I'm serving Jesus." Amen. Woo-hoo, right? I mean, he gave all the, and all those guys were all like, they were waiting for him to confess a sin or say a certain prayer. He bypassed all the religious stuff and he just said, "Today I'm serving Jesus." Hallelujah. It was amazing. I thought, wow, God got all the glory from that. Everybody in that room knew that man, that moment, said yes to Jesus. It was a great moment, amen? And that's what it's about, is us sharing our love of God with the world around us so they can come to know Jesus too and be free like we're supposed to be free. The only reason you feel guilty in your life right now is because Satan has told you a bunch of lies. Stop believing them. Okay? Can you do that right now? Would you stop believing all your shortcomings, everything that you have, your problems? There's a verse saying that he wants to hold you down from the glory of God that's in your life. Be strong in God. Be strong in God. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's stand. I'm going to close with that. I want to stand just for a second. Tino said, "Should we play some music?" No, let's not play some music. Let's just be honest with each other, right? Let's just do this. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? Huh? You answer the question yourself. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Because that's where eternal life is. And if you do, you have to also believe that the blood that he shed on that cross was for you and me and for forgiveness of our sin, the forgiveness of our guilt, forgiveness of our past, All those generational curses is gone in the name of Jesus. Everybody close your eyes. Just receive that in the name of Jesus. Just close your eyes and have faith on Jesus. Don't look at me. Just listen to the words. Don't look at me. Just look at have faith on Jesus. Think about him. He's hanging on the cross, and all the blood, every ounce of blood was cupped out of his body so he could be the complete sacrifice for your sin and my sins, for my healing and your healing, for your deliverance from past sins and from past hurts or past abuses, and mine. Every one of them are gone in the name of Jesus. Just say it right now. Everyone is gone in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Everyone is gone in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Receive now the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Your bodies are now temples of the Holy Spirit. If you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and the Holy Spirit is going to guide you and lead you to all truth. And that's his responsibility to you and me today. And he's going to empower us. He's going to empower you to do his will here on earth. That is to share Jesus with a lost and dying world. Hallelujah. Father, I pray that you embolden us to do your work. And with love and compassion, reach out to a world around us, God. And with joy unspeakable and full of glory, God, we'll give you all the praise and all the honor. And I thank you for everyone that is here today, God. I thank you that we are here to surrender our lives to you. That we are the church. We are your body. We are your example to the world. And Father, I pray that our light shine brightly. Jesus, precious and holy and glorious and wonderful and powerful name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. If you want to talk more about that, see me after service. I want to share more with you. But I do want to pray. I just remembered, maybe the Holy Spirit reminded me. I want to pray for Rajiv before we go. Can we just come here? Just stand right there. Put everybody. Yeah, there you go. There's